Merci pour l'invitation. J'aime trop la langue française pour l'utiliser dans les 10 minutes dans lesquelles je dois parler de beaucoup de choses, donc je dois aller trop vite. So I think that my role here is just to provide some background statistics that we will refer to in the roundtable later on. If you look at the growth from a global perspective, it seems that the 2009 is just an exceptional year in a long period of strong growth. So it's like a sort of parenthesis, you know. And indeed, that in 2010 and 2011, we are somewhat back to normal. However, behind this aggregate data, if you look at the composition of growth in the different areas of the world, the situation is much different. And indeed, I think the key issue is that we have been back in the 80s. We were at the time in which growth was largely synchronized in the different parts of the world. These different lines display advanced economies, emerging economies, and the Eurozone. Later on, in the mid-90s, the growth rates start being less synchronized, and there were divergence in there was an increasing divergence in growth rates among these different areas of the world. And what is bound to happen after the crisis is that this divergence will be even stronger than before. So different areas of the world proceeding at a much different speed. And it is in this context that we should really see the future for the Eurozone, for the countries of Europe. Weaker growth than in other parts of the world, and certainly much weaker recovery from the 2009 crisis. Clearly, all of this will make it more difficult to deal with the debt crisis in the Eurozone. These are the data describing how this debt crisis was built up. There was a huge transfer of private debt that was, in a way, became a public debt as the public sector government were intervening heavily in rescuing banks. And this clearly has given us, as a result of all this, a strong increase in the level of public debt with respect to GDP. And clearly this means that there will be a strong fiscal consolidation to take place if we want at least to stabilize the debt at the levels. This is the last column in this table, provides estimate of the primary balance surplus that is required to stabilize the debt to GDP ratio at the 2014 levels. This type of adjustment is something not unprecedented. Many countries have already been adjusting and been involved. There are several episodes in which this type of primary surplus has been achieved by individual countries. But what is unprecedented is the fact that this adjustment has to take place simultaneously in all of these countries. And that clearly the concerns also about the effect of this fiscal consolidation on growth in Europe arise just because of this simultaneous adjustment that should take place in all countries at the same time. To give you another idea of the type of effort that has to be made by governments to deal with debt crisis, this is the acceleration that had to take place in the fiscal consolidation in the euro zone and abroad after the explosion of the Greek crisis. You see above in what were the plans before the Greek crisis, and below you see the plans after the Greek crisis. So as you can see, the fiscal balance, you know, had to be really adjusted at a much faster pace than was initially envisaged. There was really no alternative than doing that, but clearly this is bound to have some effect on the growth prospect of the euro area. Also, there was a change in monetary policy. Monetary policy was supposed initially to be, there was envisaged an earlier exit from the quantitative easing. Clearly, this type of things has been postponed, as this chart displaying the performance and behavior of the nominal and real interest rate is showing. And I think that, in a way, this was the right decision to be made. There is currently perhaps too much concern about inflationary pressure and the idea that central banks should cope with inflation. I mean, I think is somewhat ill-suited. You know, the primary objective right now is still one of the financial stability. Let me show you some data on the recovery from the trough of the recession in the euro area. There are also within the euro area much differences in this respect, because as you can see, there are countries like Germany that have almost entirely recovered the ground lost. And here we have also to take into account of the data for the fourth quarter of 2010 that just came out. So the Germany is largely back to the levels before the crisis. But there are other countries, notably the countries of the southern part of Europe, that are instead lagging behind. So Italy in particular suffered a huge drop of GDP comparable to that of Germany, but then it recovered only marginally that level. And clearly the key concern also are related to the growth potential in Spain and in Portugal, two areas and two countries that are really, really facing a serious debt crisis. Much of the support for growth will come from the growth of the emerging countries and the export, more than from domestic consumption, also as a result of the fact that unemployment has been growing very much, not as much as the numbers that Raghu Rajan was displaying before about the US, but in some countries like Spain, unemployment has been increasing substantially during the recession. So clearly the support will come largely from external demand, and clearly for this country to benefit from the demand arising in particular from this fast-growing part of the world, competitiveness has to be restored. But here there are clearly serious issues of competitiveness for a number of countries in the southern part of Europe. This is a measure of competitiveness, the unit labor cost, that shows very well that why Germany is doing so well right now. It is doing so well also because it's competitive, improved substantially vis-a-vis the other countries in the euro areas. So to conclude, just to address very quickly some of the issues that we will go back during the round table, is there a risk that some country will leave the euro soon? I think the right answer, to be short, is that this is very unlikely. In principle, it is impossible under the current legal rules, but I think it's going to be very difficult to avoid such a, very unlikely to avoid such a such a decision in the case of the restructuring of the sovereign debt in some of the countries. In that case, it would be very difficult to see a country having no possibility to really change the exchange rate. Another issue that perhaps we are going to discuss later on is the idea of having two euros, moving to a world of two euros, the northern and the southern Europe. I doubt that this is a feasible idea. The transition to such a world with two euros is going to be a nightmare, with substantial capital flights from the countries that are moving to the weak euro part. I also don't think that that would solve the external imbalances in the eurozone, because the type and the extent of the adjustment taking place by the exchange rate is often overestimated. But certainly, they real issues instead to deal with this problem of competitiveness that I was, which the data was showing before. This is really the challenge for governments in the southern part of Europe. And about fiscal policy coordination, here these are the serious issues to be addressed. I think the rules, the fiscal rules under the Stability and Growth Pact would seem not to be really dealing with a major issue that came out during the recession. The major issues came in the transformation of private debt into public debt, more than in fiscal discipline by the individual countries. Seems to be a bit odd that countries are struggling to impose that individual governments do not go beyond 3% budget deficit rule when overnight a government like Ireland can decide almost unilaterally to provide state support to banks amounting to some 25% of GDP. So really the big issues relate to the transformation of private debt into public debt, the way in which bank rescues and state support to banks has been decided. It seems to me that really the issue here is to be able to be more selective in deciding when government should intervene, when there is really a systemic risk involved, and therefore the government are supposed to intervene. But really, I don't want to take more of your time, and I think we will go back to this issue during the panel discussion. So thank you again for the time you gave me.